he was kind of voicing the opinion that he wanted to do these kind of songs. And one of the songs he played to me was Roll On Babe.
Everybody wrote him off, thought he's loony, you know. What's he going to do as a solo artist? You know?
He was in a pretty bad emotional way. He was very upset and he was concerned because he didn't have any money. So I said, look, it's really simple. I'm free on Thursday. We'll book a studio and we'll go in and we'll make a single. And that will get you going.
With Gallagher and Lyle on stage, we have, with a fantastic sound, Mr. Ronnie Lane! Whoa.
Was loose, and yet he was very clear how it should be done. As far as I remember, it was one or two takes, you know, as it should be. You know. Everybody knew we'd caught something special. We did that first tour with him, and it was great fun. I mean, it was crazy. We were serious, Benny and I, you know. It was a bit of a shock to work with such a showman.
That was a great period of time because Stevie Wonder was on the same show. He was doing Living for the City. And when Ronnie was doing How Come, figuring out playing the riffs and everything, I saw Stevie figuring out what we were playing, and I could see him playing along, waiting for his next turn. And I just thought, oh, what a wonderful period of time to be in. You know, it was great.
This is the band of Slim Chance, aptly named.
The point was is that I didn't think the band was going to do that well anyway because... Everything was so heavy. You know, I'm not talking about heavy metal. I'm talking about kind of heavy rock and roll. And that's not what I was going to do.
Well, in the morning, we'll have to pretend again, smiling. You've been my good friend, my dear homie. Well, that comes a-creeping in the morning. The curtain will rise again. Oh, I know, because I've done this one before.
Nobody knew when we were starting, what songs we were going to play, how we were going to end the songs. And I loved it. I just thought, well, this is the way to, you know, this is the way to do it.
We played Reading Town Hall when there were more people in the band than there were in the audience. This was really difficult. All right, come on down. So he brought everybody down into the front rows and he played his set. And they had a great time. And those 12 people had the best show they'd ever get in their lives because by the end of it, he knew them all by their first name. You know.
I asked for the moon.
The idea for The Poacher came to me when I was living in a fortune teller's caravan by the side of the River Thames at Pete Townsend's back garden.
He was homeless, I think, at the time. And they lived like gypsies down the bottom. He used to cook in the open air.
Writing a song, to me anyway, is a bit like going fishing, you know? And you wait for something to come along and get a bite, you know?
It would have been a hit had it not been for the BBC technician strike at the time. We turned up to do the Top of the Pops and were told there wouldn't be any Top of the Pops for a few weeks, by which time the record was dead. It had lost its place in the charts. So he would have had his two hit singles. Whether he would have wanted to capitalize on that, I don't know, because he definitely wanted to prove to himself he wanted out of a particular way of life into another. I remember him buying the fish pool. He had all the money in a plastic bag. I think it was a lot more money than the place was worth.
I said, holy shit, you're gonna live here? And the barns are falling down and stuff. Oh, it'll be great, Russell, just you wait. Because it was derelict.
It was like stepping back in time. It really was basic. We opened the farm gate, walked up to the door, and there was a gold disc nailed to the front door, and that was, obviously, this was Ronnie's place.
I mean, I used to go up there and help him. We'd nail a few sort of weatherboards up, you know, and we'd feel very pleased with ourselves and go and have half a dozen barley wines to celebrate, you know. Felt like we were getting down to earth, you know, doing work on the house.
Some of that attitude seeped through into the album, I think. When you listen to it, you get that feeling. It was a gypsy life, you know.
Ronnie woke up one morning, it was a nice spring day, and he went out on the side of a hill with a cup of tea and his guitar and was plunking around on the guitar. And one by one, as the band woke up, they went out, sat down, and then they'd drag out another instrument. And it just kept evolving like that all morning. It must have been over like 3 or 4 hours. And they kept switching instruments and trying this, trying that, and it kept going through take after take.
These were the days where you could do things like that, to go outside and record with the sounds of the birds and the sheep in the fields and all that. Hey, won't you come on with me? I hear the neighbor's dogs is barking, and soon the country all around him will come to look the same. There's a place from where they came.
And everything was done live right there and then. And the kids, when the track fades, you can hear the kids because they were all on the hill playing.
I remember the local farmer, his neighbor, interrupted us at the very end saying, Ronnie, have you seen one of my sheep? It strayed, you know.
Is a pop star, an ex-member of the Faces group, who had a hit with this song, his first solo record. Bored with the trappings of the star, the flash motors, private jets, five-star hotels, rich food and a beaming bank manager that all of us dislike so much, our Ron has opted out.
Ronnie said he was going to do the Parson show. He hired a big marquee off of a bloke called Wally Lackins.
I remember driving up there and looking at these really tacky plywood things they were trying to disguise as a frontage, you know, and this ragged tent. This just looked like a shambles that it was.
been a smile on your face. Come straight from your heart.
Wally assured me that he would have generators, that the power wouldn't be a problem. He knew exactly what I needed. Everything was fine. Of course, he didn't. He didn't have a clue, obviously.
Ronnie wanted to do it like real circus people. And when you put up a circus tent, everybody gets out to help. So, you know, all of a sudden you have a lot of very stoned out, hungover rock and roll players trying to hold poles of them. Wipes the sleep from
my eyes. Captain Hill, lion tamer, bullshitter. One of the cleverest men I've ever come across.
I joined Ronnie Lane, I believe it was second week they was out in May 74. I come and took over as tent master mechanic and general dog's body.
And suddenly it was tight as a drum, it looked absolutely wonderful. To wake up with you,
it makes my morning so bright. And we went to outlying districts and outlying villages that they could never ever dream of seeing such thing on their doorstep like. And Ronnie was trying to take the music to the people, which he succeeded in. And it goes on and on, way beyond and out of reach.
Go and tell everyone. I do remember being part of the bus. The fact that you lived on there and we slept on there and we ate on there, it was pretty amazing.
That would always be set up with the fire going and the cooking done on the outside. Ronnie be out there with his crate of barley wine.
They could buy anything they wanted, but they was much happier having a fire outside and the pot of stew, a roast potato, a cup of tea. You know, they loved it. To sit out there, we all sat there as a family. He'd take his fishing rod and when we was up in Scotland and them up there, he didn't care, like Ronnie Lane or no Ronnie Lane. He'd put his bag on, away he'd go, come back with some trout or something. Loved it. We had no generator and Ronnie said, what are we going to do?
Closest one I could find was in Scarborough, 200 miles away or so. But I didn't make it back in time for the first show on Friday night, so they ran the Friday night show off the men's toilet. And they worked with a monitor system and two floodlights. And they loved it. You know, it was a great time. Really intimate little scene. I don't suppose there were 100 people there at most, you know.
When you build up the circus, you go out 3 weeks or 2 weeks before, build it all up so people know you're going there. But this wasn't happening with the Luckins. They was building it up the day before. So, consequently, when he got to these gigs, nobody didn't know the show was on. It was in the Carlisle football grounds there. And I think the most he had in one night was about 40 people, which was very discouraging.
Well, we'd go around on the truck and handing out leaflets.
You know, we tried everything to make it work. The Dawes family, who were hopeless as a clown actor, as general help or whatever, we finally gave them and the mini in the caravan and 100 quid sent them to Falkirk to do the advanced postering. When I got there, he said, oh, we've done this and we've done that, but we could not find a poster in that town, you know, and if you've got to go look for a poster, then it's not been billed very well, you know. But for the most part, we were just absolutely drained just trying to move from A to B. A couple hundred miles was all it was, but it was a two-day effort. For instance, with Ronnie's little gypsy van that he pulled behind the bus eventually, it was meant to be pulled behind a steam tractor back in 1910, right? I mean, it's not meant to travel more than 5-6 miles an hour. Well, if you go 20 miles an hour, this thing would fishtail all over the road.
And some of the vehicles, they were still, just as they'd been come out of the winter quarters, out of the barn, they were still got the hens parked in the front and all the hen muck and everything. When we had the tractor with the 2 or 3 trailers on, and I used to tow 2 or 3 trailers, we'd be down to 15 miles an hour on some of the roads. But we always kept in convoy. Then if anything went wrong, I could stop, mend, repair, and we'd get it going again within an hour, like.
When Ronnie's engine blew, I think that blew his heart too, I think. His bus finally gave up on him. He finally decided that was it. Jimmy Jewell's wife, and I think Bruce's wife, used to take care of the box office. And they would normally keep the cash box. The next morning, we'd go to Jimmy Jewell to get the money, and there's a note on his door. Said, goodbye, cruel circus. I'm off to join the world. I've taken your cash box receipts, take it out of my holiday pay. They pissed off to London with the only money we had.
Because that passing show comes from Amir Hababa saying, life is just a passing show. In other words, life's a joke. I think he said, life's a joke, the only thing that's serious is God.
Well, it turned out as it turned out. Russell, I and Ronnie had one thing in common at the end of it. We'd all given it our all, and we were all skint. All did our bunts on a silly thing like the passing show.
I think he lost a lot of money, but he wasn't concerned about the money. It was a thing he wanted to do.
I'm very, very glad I did it. I would much rather have done it and gone down the pan than played it safe and missed it.
He did learn to sail again, as they say. He got out there, got the band back together again.
I'm gonna meet you on that morning. I'm gonna find you with no warning. But I won't bring you flowers, that's a fine song by the road. And cut glass in a make. You already got to go, you got to go.
Bruce and I kind of dropped out of it. We all needed to earn a living. That was the problem.
Everybody was interested, what's Ronnie Lane doing here, you know?
Yeah.
He's walked out of the industry, but he's doing something interesting. It may not be commercial in the sense that the other stuff was.
Not in terms of big record companies,
no.
And huge advances and all that stuff.
That's right. But people realised it was significant, and if you look at how it influenced other groups afterwards, you can see that musically everybody was watching him. He recorded Anniversary, which when he got the idea of the Fishbowl Philharmonic, didn't he?
Yeah,
like, you know, with the twin fiddles.
That's us.
Yeah, that's you and me, Steve. And he realised there was potential in that, and it was a big crowd pleaser, wasn't it? Normally, if you had two fiddle players together, you'd bring in the trained players, rather than people like you and me to do it.
Yeah,
you know.
You suddenly started playing accordion at that point.
Yeah, well, Ronnie threw this accordion at me and said, you're playing this.
Yeah,
I'm like, well.
Because he had such limited funds, he had, I don't know, 8 reels of 2-inch tape or something, and that was it. And I think he made 2 or 3 albums on the same reels of tape. He never put leader in at the end of a master or anything, so he could reuse the reel. So once they'd mixed it, he just erased the masters of the previous album and start again on the same reel as the day. I just think that's priceless.
Well, there was me, Lukey, Mum Ronnie in Fishpool, but even then it was never just us.
I think half the population in the area used to show up at the farm at one time or another. And some of them would sit outside and some of them would sit in the cottage and always all have a good time. It was quite a cosmic place. It's probably on ley lines or something, if Kate had anything to do with it.
Ronnie's farm was something else. It really was. When I first went up there, and all the wagons out the back and stuff. A couple of times I had one of those big wooden boys, you know, that you've seen the navvies bringing shovels out of, like, and huge things, you know, and I used to annoy the shit out of everybody because I would have put on traditional Irish music at 4 o'clock in the morning, half ripped.
Eric Clapton used to come down and visit regularly, and I think he just really enjoyed the fact that he had his own space around here. Nobody knew him.
We went at it hard together, up on the borders and in and out of the pubs and playing and everything.
And then the next album was coming together. It was that wonderful hot summer, wasn't it?
Yeah, 76.
Harvest Home was recorded outdoors. Wasn't
outdoors,
it?
Yeah.
It was the same Blackbird double tracking himself on the fiddle track.
One for the Road is almost nearly all of it, if not all of it. I think it was originals. It was, wasn't it? It was self-penned, the whole thing.
Ronnie had submersed himself in the locale, hadn't he?
That was my life at the time, so I always try and write while I'm living.
And it was a bit of a vignette of Shropshire life, a lot of it.
Yes.
Some Shropshire characters entered into it.
Tom Caulfield.
Local farmer guy,
Who, when he wanted a bit of extra help weeding his artichokes.
Yes.
His boys weren't doing anything, right. So we got sent out.
Yeah. And they're recording
his artichokes.
Exactly. Well, I loved all that myself.
Yeah. It was great. It really worked.
Yeah.
It did work.
We had a lovely lady that Mama Ronnie used to rely on quite a lot to look after us, called Annie. And she lived just behind us and to the right.
It seemed like she was some kind of spiritual grandmother for everybody. You know, everybody had incredible respect for her.
Old oaks stand tall, Annie, seen the world grow small, Annie. But will they fall, Annie, where will we be?
I just thought she added a sweetness and goodness coming out of her, and I don't remember how the song was written, but it was all out of that love, you know. When I got involved with him musically, he took me to a place that I didn't even know I could go to, that I could really just talk about and write about what was happening in my life right now. Up until then, I probably still was very much under the influence of things that were much more abstract.
I'd like to introduce you to the band. That's Chrissy Stewart on the bass. There's Bruce Rodham on the drums. You've already met Henry over there, so we'll come to this side, yeah? There's Charlie Hart on the accordion. We have Mr. Ian Stewart on the piano. We have Mother and Son, George and Raymond Carlis.
The ethic was about the musicians run the show. I mean, the whole thing with Slim Chance and the travelling show and all of that was that, you know, you bypassed or you short-circuited the industry, and you stepped outside of the promotion or all of the bullshit that I still I find really difficult to deal with, you know. He found a way to sidestep all that and make it, bring it back to what it was supposed to be, music.
So they'd all be at the pub and then they'd all rock back here, get the campfire going and carry on drinking to the early hours of the morning.
A lot of what we did was in character, but it wasn't very real, you know. I mean, Ronnie wasn't really a farmer, but we were sort of playing the part.
She taught me life is sweet and God is good.
Nevertheless, it cultivated a lot of really strong stuff. I mean, I wrote Wonderful Tonight around the campfire down there with Ronnie. Oh, it was very, very powerful stuff.
But I see Katie pretending to be a farmer's wife, boiling Ronnie's clothes, you know, in a bucket on the stove, his satin suits and shit. Ruining all of his suits, because that's the way she thought farmers did it.
As far as living the part and looking the part, Ronnie was fulfilling Kate's fantasy. But on the practical side, he didn't know anything about animals.
I think he felt quite insecure about it all, because there was actually a lot more to it than he thought.
There ain't nobody quite like you. Oh, bless my soul, she swears on Sunday, always he pays the truth. Whose lingo comes from God knows where, and it's sure enough money. Who was also knows how mocked I am when you call me a thirsty rag. So I said, hey.
He had a lot of friends that were gypsies, and we're talking, you know, your real traditional, you know, Romany gypsies. Arthur took him under his wing. Arthur would take him out and about scouting. God knows what they were doing, I haven't got a clue. We used to go up to the horse fairs in Appleby, and the most amazing scene. Ronnie loved that.
Arthur schooled him in a way that made it possible for Ronnie to talk about doing practical things without actually having to do them. It's quite funny. Christy Wright, yeah, all came from Arthur. He was a big influence on Ronnie at that time.
We busted our ass schlepping around the country doing clubs, and to see the rates going down from 1,000 a night to £800 a night to 500 a night, you know. You put a record out and it never hit the charts. You know, I think, fuck me, you know. All right, well, let's do the new album. Then we'll do a new deal with another company. Then we'll go to America. It was always, we'll get to America. We'll get to, that's what I was waiting on. I was, because I knew he could probably crack it better in the States, you know. It was there. If he would get into certain markets like Detroit, San Francisco, those areas, they would take to him. Ronnie says he's always sat there by the fire, staring into the fire, you know, thinking, what am I going to do, Russell? I'm going to call Townsend. Pete might help.
Let's talk about the album. When did you first start putting plans together for that LP?
Well, last summer, really. I had a few songs, and Pete had a few songs, and a couple of songs came along the way.
I said, I'll make this album, but I insist that Glyn Johns produces it.
I thought it was great. I thought it was a great idea. But my concern, which I voiced at the time, was that they were doing it for the wrong reason, perhaps.
Glyn is such a craftsman, and he knows how to handle those two entities. I mean, such egos he has to deal with. And Rough Mix is a perfect name, because they couldn't be any different, those two.
I got to meet and work with Eric properly for the first time.
In fact, I've always wanted to work with Pete, but never really been able to figure out how to manage it. And it was Ronnie that got the between the two of us and really brought us together. So, I mean, in a way, Ronnie has been an incredible catalyst. And that's what it was with Rough Mix, you know.
I think it was great. It was one of the best records I ever made, I think.
I know for a fact he remembers the earliest symptoms of MS. He couldn't hold a plectrum, or his hand would be numb in the morning, as early as 73. And he put it down to too much cocaine or too much alcohol, you know.
I remember at Fishpool in the quite early days, we used to drink a lot, all of us. We were heavy drinkers. So a hangover wasn't an unusual thing. So in the morning, wasn't unusual. I thought he's been at it already, you know. There was always a crate of barley wine around the place. But it wasn't. I think that's when the illness was starting to creep in. He didn't know it. Nobody else knew it at that time.
I went to put a bass on a song that I'd recorded, and I couldn't do it. And I thought, that's odd.
And he started complaining about his thumb. And I saw him play a few times where he wasn't actually hitting the strings. He's doing up and down strokes with the pick, but it was sort of just hovering about. And I thought, what's going on here?
Ronnie knew what he got at Fishpool. I'm convinced of that. And he got ill and got taken to hospital in Birmingham, I think, where they gave him. Said, do you know, you're like, is there anything in your family that you think might have given you this? Yeah. And he said, no. And they gave him a lumbar puncture, but he kept stum and had two more. It's one of the most horrendous, painful procedures. So, like, he was in total denial.
I didn't like him anymore, you know. He just wasn't likable.
And, you know, a lot of it was he was drinking heavily or appeared to be drinking heavily. It might be that he drank normally but just got belligerently pissed, you know. And it could be the MS setting in on him or whatever.
God, he could be objectionable. He really could. The only way to, deal with it was tell him to shove it up his ass or, like, make it clear to him you just weren't having that and you weren't impressed. And, and turn away from him and go, you know, go to Christ, it works. And mostly it did.
And he was still, I mean, he was a pain. He was even more of a pain in the ass, Ronnie. I mean, he was always a pain in the ass. But we love him. You know, I loved him and I love him still. But there was something about him being ill that gave him some kind of edge. Do you know what I mean? That he would employ in the wind-up.
I could see everything was just turning in the vicious circle. We were never going to get to the States. So I said, Ronnie, I'm leaving. I'm going to go home to Ohio. So that was the end of my Ronnie Lane career, really.
1979 Reuben was born. And that winter, I think, basically saw off the total animal population on the farm. Luke has told me of a time when Ronnie had temporary blindness and he was in control of the tractor and he just said, look, you're going to have to drive this tractor, son, because I can't see. And Luke could have only been about 4 or 5. But that was what was happening quite regularly towards the end. And I personally think that was why we moved to London when we did.
I think he knew himself that his time with Kate was like a fairground rider. Sooner or later, you're going to have to get off. You know, it didn't smack of permanence ever. I don't know where Boo came from. She picked him up and sorted him out. Boo Oldfield, yeah. He came just at the right time. And she kept him on an even keel. Again, like, I think he missed his kids and he was sad that it had gone wrong with Kate.
He was getting very introspective and he was struggling to get into a van. Standing holding the van going like that. He can't get up and he gets in and he finally sits down and he says to me, is my disease showing? And for a second, I thought, like, he's winding me up.
From there on, I thought, well, it's not going to get me like it got my mother, because my mother got very negative, bless her. And now I know why she got so negative, because it's a very negative disease.
You know, he knew it was all over, and he was torn between going for it and kind of folding it all up.
The disease had got my speech to the point where I spoke like I'd drunk about 5 bottles of whiskey. And in actual fact, I couldn't talk until I took some hyperbaric oxygen, which is pure oxygen under pressure, like what they give the divers with the bends. And that kind of cleared up the speech thing a bit. Well, it still hasn't come back perfect. So I thought, perhaps I could do something about this lousy disease. So I tried and I thought, my mate Eric Clapton.
Eric Clapton was originally approached by Ronnie and Ronnie approached me almost at the same time. He said, would I put a band together?
The thing just took off, you know, and everybody was on board who was available. Everyone was clearly very keen to do it.
What I enjoyed most was everyone backing Ronnie Lane and supporting him. You know, Jimmy Page, Eric Clapton, Jeff Beck, Charlie Watts, Andy Fairweather Lowe, Bill Wyman.
It's the supergroup of all time, rehearsing for a concert tonight at the Royal Albert Hall. Ronnie Lane says he can't do enough for MS research. Their treatment helped him to keep going when his own rock career had to end.
It's nice to see rock and roll doing something so necessary. That's what it is. It's necessary. You see, MS doesn't kill you, but it will cripple you for the rest of your life. That makes it easier for people to sort of look the other way, because it doesn't kill you.
Many people might think that the rock business is a pretty hard world. Do you think something like this perhaps gives the lie to that?
Well, the rock business is a hard world, but it's the managers and that is the hard world, not the musicians. The musicians are lovely.
Really?
Even the Rolling Stones.
Thank you.